From New York, this is Democracy Now!
What is happening right now is not the end of the affair, but it might just be the beginning of the move of the far right to try to catapult itself to power.
As House Democrats move to impeach President Trump for inciting a violent insurrection, the FBI is warning of armed right-wing protests at all 50 state capitals this weekend. We'll speak to Filipino scholar Walden Bella, author of Counter-Revolution, The Global Rise of the Far Right, his latest piece, America Has Entered the Weimar Era. Then we look at President Trump's race to execute more prisoners before his term ends in an unprecedented lame duck killing spree.
I think it's the callous brute force of the mentality of the Trump administration that he just believes that he can use force and kill people. He can use violence and force to make his point. There's no need for these executions to happen.
On Monday, a federal judge granted a stay of execution for Lisa Montgomery, who is set to become the first woman executed by the federal government in almost 70 years. But the Trump administration is appealing the decision. Two men are also scheduled to be executed this week. We'll speak with longtime death penalty critic Sister Helen Prejean. Stay with us. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. House Democrats are inching toward removing President Trump from power after he incited his supporters to attack the U.S. Capitol last Wednesday. On Monday, the House adjourned for the day after Republicans objected to a voice vote on a measure calling on Vice President Mike Pence to invoke the 25th Amendment. The House is set to vote on that measure today. Pence has signaled he's unlikely to declare Trump incapable of executing his duties, and such a move would also require a majority of Trump's cabinet members. Democratic leaders have scheduled an impeachment vote for Wednesday. More than 218 lawmakers have already committed to passage of the single article of impeachment, charging Trump with inciting violence against the government of the United States. Senate Republican leader Mitch McConnell has adjourned the Senate until January 19th, all but ruling out a Senate impeachment trial ahead of Joe Biden's inauguration January 20th. Biden on Monday questioned whether the Senate could bifurcate its business during his first 100 days, suggesting senators could hold off on an impeachment trial in order to get cabinet members confirmed. Meanwhile, at least 47 lawmakers are co-sponsoring a resolution by freshman Missouri Democrat Congressmember Cori Bush, calling for the removal of Republicans who encouraged last week's insurrection at the Capitol. The FBI's warning armed protests are being planned in all 50 state capitals and in Washington, D.C., before and during Joe Biden's inauguration next week. In Michigan, authorities have banned the open carry of firearms inside the state capitol building, hoping to avoid a repeat of last April when heavily armed militia members menaced lawmakers during a vote to extend public health measures during the pandemic. In Washington, D.C., Pentagon officials say up to 15,000 National Guard members could be deployed to protect against a replay of last week's insurrection. Washington Mayor Muriel Bowser's calling on the Department of Homeland Security and other federal agencies to dramatically increase security for the inauguration, but says the event should remain public. President-elect Biden said Monday he will take the oath of office publicly. This comes as the Washington Post reports that during Wednesday's insurrection, Republican leaders tried repeatedly and failed to get Trump to call off the mob he incited. Trump reportedly could not be reached because he was too busy watching the crisis unfold on live television for hours. Connecticut Democratic Senator Chris Murphy said Monday Trump is continuing to thwart attempts to secure the January 20th inauguration.
President Trump is still in charge. And part of the reason why Congress is talking about impeachment right now is because he is not being helpful in trying to guarantee the security of the inauguration. In fact, he seems to be doing more harm than good.
Washington, D.C.'s attorney general said Monday he's considering riot incitement charges against President Trump Jr., against Donald Trump Jr., as well as his attorney Rudy Giuliani and Republican Congressmember Mo Brooks for inciting Trump's mob to violence. He's considering charges against the president. On Monday, acting Homeland Security Secretary Chad Wolf resigned, becoming the third cabinet secretary to quit since Trump's mob attacked Congress last week. In his resignation letter, Wolf did not refer directly to the Capitol Hill assault. Instead, he said he was quitting because of legal challenges to his authority to run DHS without Senate confirmation. Authorities are still looking for those responsible for planting pipe bombs outside the Republican and Democratic National Committee headquarters last Wednesday and for fatally wounding Capitol Police Officer Brian Sicknick, who was struck in the head by a fire extinguisher. The U.S. Army is investigating an active-duty PSYOPs officer who led a contingent of insurrectionists to Washington, D.C. last week. Captain Emily Rainey of the 4th Psychological Operations Group says she led 100 members of a conservative group to D.C. to, quote, stand against election fraud. Meanwhile, the Capitol Police Department has suspended two officers for their involvement with or support for last week's insurrection, among them an officer who put on a red MAGA hat and directed rioters around the Capitol, and another who posed for selfies with insurrectionists. More than a dozen officers are under investigation. The United States recorded 223,000 coronavirus cases Monday and more than 2,000 deaths. The U.S. has averaged more than 3,000 COVID-19 deaths per day over the past week and could pass 400,000 deaths before President-elect Joe Biden sworn in January 20th. Arizona remains the worst-affected state, but Republican Governor Doug Ducey continues to refuse to issue a statewide mask mandate. On Monday, hundreds of teachers in Arizona's Peoria Unified School District staged a massive sick-out to protest unsafe classrooms. This comes as many bars and restaurants across Arizona remain open for indoor dining. Meanwhile, gorillas at the San Diego Zoo in California have tested positive for coronavirus, showing mild symptoms. Zookeepers say it's the first known instance of natural transmission of the virus to great apes. At least two members of Congress have contracted COVID-19 after Wednesday's insurrection. Democrat Bonnie Watson Coleman of New Jersey, a 75-year-old cancer survivor, believes she was exposed during protective isolation as Trump supporters rampaged through the Capitol. Video shows several Republican lawmakers in the cramped isolation space refusing to wear face masks. Also testing positive, Congressmember Pramila Jayapal, who's been quarantining at home since the riots. Jayapal said any lawmaker who refuses to wear a mask should be fined and removed by the House Sergeant at Arms. Six lawmakers, all of them Republicans, previously tested positive since the 118th Congress was sworn in on January 3rd. Most lawmakers have received a single dose of the Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine, but have not yet received their second shot, which confers better protection against the disease. In Delaware, President-elect Joe Biden received his second shot of the two-dose Pfizer-BioNTech COVID-19 vaccine Monday. Pfizer said it expects to boost output of its vaccine to 2 billion doses this year amid surging demand. The U.S. has secured contracts for 200 million of those doses, with another 600 million promised to the European Union. In Geneva, World Health Organization officials warned Monday it's unlikely most countries will reach herd immunity through vaccination in 2021. WHO advisor Bruce Aylward called on wealthy countries and drug companies to do more to provide vaccines to the world's poorer nations.
Over 40 countries have now begun vaccinating against COVID-19 using five different COVID vaccines. However, all of that vaccination, or virtually all of it, as the Director General has emphasized, were in the high-income and upper-middle-income countries so far.
Coronavirus cases continue to surge in southern Africa. Zimbabwe officials have banned traditional funerals amidst a spike in COVID-19 linked to funeral rites. In Johannesburg, South Africa, a government-run hospital has moved COVID-19 patients into a parking lot after all available beds filled to capacity. In Lebanon, officials have ordered an 11-day, 24-hour curfew beginning Thursday. The order sparked panic buying at grocery stores with fears crowded markets will lead to further community spread. Meanwhile, the Portuguese president, Marcelo Rebelo de Sousa, announced Monday he tested positive for coronavirus and is isolating his official residence in Lisbon without symptoms. Portugal currently has one of the highest infection rates in Europe, with nearly 8,000 deaths since the start of the pandemic. The Trump administration's placed Cuba back on a list of state sponsors of terrorism, reversing an Obama-era decision to remove the label over 5 years ago. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo Monday accused Cuba of granting safe harbor to terrorists and attacked the country's support for Venezuela. The Cuban foreign minister, Bruno Rodriguez, condemned the move as hypocritical and cynical. On Twitter, he said, quote, "The U.S. political opportunism of this action is recognized by anyone with an honest regard for the scourge of terrorism and its victims," he said. Yesterday marked 19 years since former President George W. Bush sent the first post-9/11 prisoners to the U.S. naval base in Guantanamo Bay, Cuba. The grim anniversary comes as human rights advocates continue to demand the closure of the U.S. military prison there, where 40 people continue to be indefinitely detained, most without being charged or receiving a fair trial. In a statement, the Center for Constitutional Rights urged the Biden administration to close the prison, saying, quote, "Today marks the beginning of the 20th shameful year of Muslim men being unlawfully imprisoned at Guantanamo. Even in a national landscape of brutal and extreme incarceration, the detentions of the men at Guantanamo are unprecedented and yet largely invisible by now," they said. The Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has ordered the construction of some 800 homes for Israeli settlers in the West Bank. Palestinian authorities have accused Israel of racing against time to build illegal settlements before President Trump leaves office next week. In 2019, the Trump administration said Israeli settlements in Palestine did not violate international law, despite a 2016 UN resolution declaring them a flagrant violation. This comes as leading Israeli human rights group B'Tselem is denouncing Israel's control of Palestinian territories as a single apartheid regime that violently perpetuates the supremacy of Israelis over Palestinians. In a statement, B'Tselem says, quote, "Israel is not a democracy that has a temporary occupation attached to it. It is one regime between the Jordan River and the Mediterranean Sea, and we must look at the full picture and see it for what it is, apartheid," they said. A South Korean court has ordered Japan to compensate women who were forced into sex slavery by Japanese troops during World War II and Japan's colonial rule over South Korea, which started in 1910. The landmark ruling stems from a lawsuit filed in 2016 by a dozen survivors. Japan's argued the two countries settled such claims in a 1965 treaty. Some estimates say up to 200,000 Korean girls and women were forced into sexual slavery by Japanese soldiers. A federal judge granted Lisa Montgomery, the only woman on federal death row, a stay of execution scheduled for this evening. The court ordered a hearing to determine Montgomery's mental competency to face execution. The government's already appealed the ruling. She would become the first woman to face federal execution in nearly 70 years. This comes as four former corrections officers from Indiana have issued a letter urging U.S. Attorney General Jeffrey Rosen to postpone the three federal executions scheduled for this week, citing safety concerns due to COVID-19. The letter, released alongside the American Civil Liberties Union, says executions at Terre Haute have led to a spike in coronavirus cases among prisoners and staff. Two men scheduled for execution later this week, Dustin Higgs and Corey Johnson, recently contracted COVID-19. Later in the broadcast, we'll speak to longtime anti-death penalty activist Sister Helen Prejean. And finally, Colorado's attorney general is opening a grand jury investigation into the police killing of Elijah McClain, a 23-year-old black man from Aurora. McClain was stopped by police as he was walking home in August 2019, tackled, placed in a chokehold, and later injected with ketamine by paramedics. He died days later. And in Bosnia, hundreds of refugees are taking shelter in abandoned buildings as they try to protect themselves from snow and freezing temperatures. This is a 16-year-old refugee from Afghanistan named Ali.
I've been sleeping in the bus for about 5 to 6 months now, and I'm living in really bad conditions. I'm in really a bad way. There's no one to look after us here, and the conditions are not safe. People who are supposed to support us have been coming and taking things from us, and then selling those things inside the camp or in other places. We have nothing here. I have explained what is going on several occasions, and others have talked about what is going on, but no one wants to listen to what we say. I'm asking if you can do anything for us, then please help us.
And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. When we come back, as House Democrats move to impeach President Trump for inciting an insurrection, the FBI's warning of armed right-wing protests at all 50 state capitals this weekend. We'll speak with Filipino scholar Walden Bello, author of Counter-Revolution, The Global Rise of the Far Right. He says America's entered the Weimar era. Stay with us.
May mga taong bulag kahit dila ang mata. May mga taong tinatali ang sariling kamay at paa. Problema'y tinatalikdan. Salamin sa mata'y hindi makita. Kay sarap ng umaga, lalo na't kung ika'y gising. Tanghali maligaya kung ika'y may makakain. Ang gabi ay mapayapa, kung mahal sa buhay ay kapiling. Kay sarap ng buhay, lalo na't alam mo saan papunta. Gising na kaibigan ko, ganda ng buhay ay nasa sayo. Ang oras daw ay ginto.
Wake up, my friend, by Bayang Barrios. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman in New York with co-host Juan Gonzalez in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Hi, Juan.
Hi, Amy, and welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world.
We're going to turn right now to what's happening in the Capitol. The Democratic-led House of Representatives plans to vote to impeach President Trump as soon as Wednesday, unless Trump resigns or Vice President Mike Pence first invokes the 25th Amendment to remove him, which looks unlikely. On Monday, House Democrats unveiled a single article of impeachment against the president for incitement of insurrection against the government of the United States, a week after Trump's supporters violently attacked the Capitol. Trump's also accused of subverting and obstructing the certification of the 2020 election. The article of impeachment states, quote, Donald John Trump, by such conduct, has demonstrated he will remain a threat to national security, democracy, and the Constitution, if allowed to remain in office, and has acted in a manner grossly incompatible with the self-governance and the rule of law. This comes as authorities are warning of more right-wing violence around Joe Biden's inauguration January 20th. The FBI's warned the possible armed fiery protests are being planned in all 50 state capitals, plus the U.S. Capitol, beginning January 16th. In Washington, 15,000 members of the National Guard are expected to be deployed ahead of the inauguration. The New York Times reports Pentagon officials are preparing for a number of nightmare scenarios, including snipers targeting attendees of the inauguration, drone attacks, and suicide-type aircraft. Authorities have also expressed concern about the number of active duty soldiers and veterans, as well as police officers, who took part in the insurrection last week. Commanders at Fort Bragg are investigating the role of a PSYOPS Army captain. That's a psychological operations Army captain who led a group from North Carolina to D.C. last week to rally for President Trump. Meanwhile, two Capitol Hill police officers have been suspended, and at least a dozen others are under investigation for aiding the attack that left five people dead, including a Capitol Hill police officer who supported Donald Trump. For an international perspective on the crisis facing the United States, we go to the Philippines to speak with Walden Bello, the acclaimed sociologist, academic, environmentalist, and activist. His latest column for Foreign Policy in Focus is headlined, America Has Entered the Weimar Era. Walden Bello is also a senior analyst at the Bangkok-based Focus on the Global South, as well as an international adjunct professor at the State University of New York at Binghamton. Bello is the author or co-author of 25 books. Part of his book, Counter-Revolution, The Global Rise of the Far Right, looks at the social roots of Trumpism. Bello served as a member of the House of Representatives of the Philippines from 2009 to 2015. He's the recipient of the Right Livelihood Award, also known as the Alternative Nobel Prize. Walden Bello, welcome back to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us. If you can talk about what you thought as the insurrection unfolded last week, if you could put this in a global context.
Yes. Well, Amy, thanks a lot, and Juan, for inviting me to your program. Well, let me just say that the first thing that came to mind was, of course, shock at this insurrection right at the very heart of the American political system. But on the other hand, having studied counter-revolutions, it was sort of something that, although I did not expect it to take this dramatic form, you know, that this kind of street-type warfare, mobilization of the streets, you know, that, you know, the right wing or the far right in the United States would, you know, resort to this. And, you know, things that came back, came to my mind were, for instance, the right-wing gangs in Chile, you know, that, you know, created the chaos that resulted in military intervention that ousted President Allende back in 1973. And, you know, we had these groups like Patria y Libertad that pretty much were like this, the Proud Boys in the United States and, you know, the other right-wing gangster. Another image that flashed into my mind was, you know, the fascist squadristi of Mussolini, you know, that took power first by taking over the streets. And because the socialists in Italy at that time were becoming quite popular at the ballot box, the you know, the ruling class fought back mainly by, you know, promoting the fascist, squads in their very violent ways of repressing the left. And of course, the other image that came to my mind was, you know, in the late 20s, the last years of the Weimar Republic, you know, where basically, you know, there was a strong political polarization that was taking place, and the fascists or the Nazis, you know, wanted to resolve the, you know, the stalemate, parliamentary stalemate, by basically taking over the streets and beating up people, beating up social democrats, beating up the communists, and using that surge from the streets to be able to push Hitler to power, both through electoral as well as a street a terrorist means. So this is not, you know, something that's unusual that has happened in the capital. Right-wing groups, when they begin to lose electorally, when they begin to see that their opponents are gaining the upper hand in terms of being able to win, you know, elections and electorally, they resort to the streets and to violence in order to, you know, stop, you know, that process. So that, those are the things that came to mind. It was very dramatic, but on the other hand, it was something that I, having studied counter-revolutions, you know, expected something like it would happen at some point in the United States, given the developments over the last, you know, few years, which has really resulted in, you know, this move to the far right of, you know, significant sectors of the population that are allied to the Republican Party.
Walden Bello, I wanted to ask you, in another article you wrote back in May titled The Race to Replace a Dying Neoliberalism, you write, and I'm quoting you, crises do not always result in significant change. It is the interaction of or synergy between two elements, an objective one, meaning a systemic crisis, and a subjective one, that is the people's psychological response to it, that is decisive. And you go on to say, unfortunately, it is the extreme right that is currently best positioned to take advantage of the global discontent. And you mentioned that in both the global North and the global South. Could you explain why that is?
Well, okay, I was referring to, you know, the fact, you know, that the global financial crisis, you know, that erupted in 2008, you know, dragged on and on without any real resolution, because, you know, the steps were not taken, you know, to really control the banks, save homeowners, and bring a significant employment back to the United States. You know, that was a very alienating process, you know, so that neoliberalism, as I said, you know, helped create, you know, this situation. So if in 2008 you did not yet have the conditions for radicalization, by the time COVID-19 erupted, you know, in 2020, the conditions were there for this polarization, this radicalization to increase even more. Now, when I say that the extreme right has been the one, you know, that has been able to benefit from this more than the left, I mean mainly, you know, that several things, you know, that there was this appeal to racism, dog whistle type Republican politics that started with, you know, Richard Nixon with the Southern Strategy. You know, so the second one was, of course, the impact of neoliberalism that created so much unemployment, deindustrialization, and especially among workers, including white workers, you had significant, you know, unemployment and deindustrialization hitting their communities. And then the fact also that so much of the working class or of the white working class began to no longer see the Democratic Party as, you know, the party that was carrying, you know, their interests, because of a sense that somehow that the Democratic Party had begun to buy into the neoliberal narrative, starting, for instance, with Clinton and up to Obama. And so there was this mass of people, white workers, you know, that was ready to be mobilized someplace. And it was Trump and the right in the United States that took advantage of that, mobilized them, but in a right-wing direction, in a racist direction, basically, you know, so that was, that's when, you know, basically you had this process of right-wing mobilization that would said, you know, you have liberals, you know, taking away what should be yours and giving that to the minorities. So explaining, you know, the economic crisis of workers in racist terms, you know. So this is the kind of base, this is the kind of heated mass that Trump was able to cultivate. Let me just say that with respect to Trumpism, you know, that Trump is as much a creature as the creator of that base. There's this synergy that's taking place, you know, there. You know, so on the other hand, when you look at the left, the left was the one that originated the critique of globalization. And unfortunately, that came from the independent left. But the broad left, what, social democrats in Europe, the Democratic Party in the United States, was pretty much seen as complicit with neoliberal pro-Wall Street policies, okay? And so, you know, that an alternative that would come from the mainstream left and the Democratic Party, you know, that was not coming at all, you know? And so what we saw happening, you know, in this process was, yes, there were great ideas coming from the left, you know, deglobalization, degrowth, fantastic ideas that were, you know, for an alternative society. The unfortunate thing is that it wasn't gaining any political traction. Right down to the grassroots there, it was just, you know, the progressives were just not gaining that kind of mass base that was very necessary. And that's why I said that, you know, especially during the Trump years, it was the right. It was people like Trump that was cherry-picking global anti-globalization and other elements of that had been offered by the left, cherry-picking them, but putting them in the right wing.
Yeah, if I can ask you about another issue in that you've focused on, and you say that the COVID-19 pandemic has really accelerated the decline of the United States as a worldwide power, and the rise of China as the continued rise of China as the industrial heartland of modern capitalism.
Yes, well, I think that. To link that to what I said earlier, so much of the deindustrialization, the shaping of jobs that took place, you know, was carried out by corporate America, and a lot of those jobs and industrial processes were shifted to China. And it was the U.S. corporate transnational class that carried this out, you know. Now, of course, China played a role there. But China was seeking developmental objectives, whereas the TNCs, the U.S. TNCs, were using it purely for exploitative purposes. So what happened basically was China became the workshop of the world. You had a massive industrial base that was created that produced value and became the center, the new center of global accumulation. Whereas what happened to the United States was deindustrialization, people thrown out of jobs, communities deindustrialized, and the economy financialized so that it became the United States economy basically began to run mainly on financialization and speculation, you know, so that core of a healthy economy that was centered on industry and the creation of value, that disappeared. And so this is, you know, this is the background of my comment that you had the creation of a strong center of capital accumulation in China that paralleled the collapse of the industrial capacity of the United States.
And how has the failure of our government to deal with COVID accelerated that?
Well, you know, my, you know, when you look at what happened, with COVID was when it hit, because so much of the supplies even of personal protective equipment had been sourced to China. And the United States was no longer capable of producing this because so much of its manufacturing capacity had been shifted over to China. Okay, that you saw that, you know, the in addition to the pandemic, you also had, you know, this crisis of global supply chains, you know, that began to stop because the Chinese economy in the first few months of 2020 also stopped, you know. So basically, you had this interaction of an economic crisis and a pandemic coming together, especially in the United States, which was, of course, accelerated by the fact that Trump never took COVID-19, you know, seriously. And, you know, so you had, you know, this concatenation of events, economic, political, and ideological, you know, that just created this tremendous crisis of leadership in the United States and an economic crisis at the same time.
So, Walden Bello, you were a young student in Chile on another September 11th, September 11th, 1973, when the Pinochet forces rose to power, overthrowing the democratically elected president of Chile. If you can talk about, I mean, you're talking about the pandemic now. 3,000 people die a day in the United States alone, by far the worst death toll in the world. 3,000 people, that's a 9/11 every single day in the United States. What does the Pinochet years have to teach us in Chile? What does the Marcos years in your home country of the Philippines, and even what's happening with Duterte today, have to teach us about President Trump and what you talk about as the crises to come in this country? I mean, the FBI just warned that in the next days we could face violent attacks in all 50 state capitals. What lessons should we understand?
Well, you know, several things, Amy. First, the key lesson that we should understand here is that when the forces of reaction, when the right begins to lose at the ballot box, begins to lose in terms of voting in parliaments, it resorts to street warfare to be able to stop the democratic process. And this is what happened in Chile. Basically, you know, we had a duly elected government, you know, and the right tried to stop it, in terms of legislatively and bureaucratically, and when it couldn't do that, then the right-wing mobs came and basically took over the streets and beat up the left and created a new situation, you know, that then, you know, invited military intervention. So, and that's where Pinochet came in, quote unquote, for the sake of political stability, but really in a process that favored the right. The second thing that comes from that is that Chile had a very proud tradition of military non-intervention in politics, you know, from the early days of the Chilean Republic. But in 1973, you know, when you had a situation of political polarization, the military came in and intervened in favor of the right. Now, what I'm saying here is that, you know, we should not underestimate or overestimate the strength of political institutions like civilian control of the military. You know, at some point, this, if there's great political polarization that takes place, then, you know, those sort of principles begin to become more loose, and we should, you know, expect, you know, that there will be elements within the security forces, within the agencies of the state that would say, hey, the civilians can't work it out. The political elite is divided. You know, we have to be the ones to stabilize the country, and we stabilize it by eliminating democracy. Okay, so basically, this is the same thing that happened in the Philippines in 1972. Marcos basically said, democracy is now stalemated. We have to move forward, and therefore we have to declare an authoritarian regime. So that's what I'm saying at this point in time, you know, that do not overestimate the strength of American political institutions, because Trump has shown, you know, over the last 4 years, how he could easily violate so many U.S. traditions. And, you know, and we have not seen the end of that, you know. I, in fact, am thinking at this point in time, you know, that since the demographic balance is going against, you know, the white population in the United States, since the political balance is going against the Republican Party. And we just saw, for instance, how Georgia, you know, and a number of other states, Arizona, have, you know, to political mobilization, have gone over to the Democrats. We saw how the popular vote was won by Biden with over 7 million votes. So basically, the political electoral weight is shifting over, you know, to the left, to the broad left, to, this coalition of progressives, liberals, and minorities. And I think, given that, I think you should be expecting more street warfare being waged by the right in the United States at this point in time. And I think this is something that people should just be prepared for, because if they can't win electorally, they'll win through trying to control the streets. And if that happens, then that creates the possibility or the opening for military intervention, you know. So I think the U.S., in fact, I think is entering what I call the Weimar period, which is basically the period of both electoral and street struggle and chaos that characterized the last days of the Weimar Republic and ended with the elevation of Hitler in 1933 to the chancellorship. So, you know, of course, things may not happen exactly the same, okay? And, you know, we should always remember that history never repeats itself in quite the same way. But at the same time, there are lessons that we should be taking, you know, from the rise of counter-revolutionary movements in the 20th century and in this century. And, you know, that the United States is not exempt from this. The United States is no longer the kind of exceptional society. The United States, as events have shown over the last few years, and especially the last few months and the last few days, is becoming more and more like the rest of the world. So this is the end of American exceptionalism.
Walden Bello, we want to thank you so much for being with us. Acclaimed Filipino scholar, activist, author of many books, including Counter-Revolution, The Global Rise of the Far Right. We'll also link to your latest piece, America Has Entered the Weimar Era, and also encourage people to go to our conversation with Alan Nairn last week, who talked about what's happened in the capital as a mild version of what the U.S. has supported abroad, for example, in Chile, in Guatemala, in El Salvador. Oh, and this breaking news. Billionaire casino owner and Republican megadonor Sheldon Adelson has died at the age of 87. Adelson was Donald Trump's largest single donor during the 2016 race. Since 2015, he donated more than $250 million to Republican candidates and right-wing super PACs. He was also an influential political power in Israel, where he used his news outlets to back Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and the expansion of illegal Israeli settlements in the occupied territories. He will be buried in Israel. Next, we look at President Trump's race to execute more prisoners before his term ends in an unprecedented lame duck killing spree. Back in 30 seconds.
Then that's God shall get, and then that's not shall lose. So the Bible says.
may have, Papa may have, but God bless the child. It's God is own.
Annie Lennox, God bless the child. This is Democracy Now!, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Four former corrections officers from Indiana have issued a letter urging U.S. Attorney General Jeffrey Rosen to postpone the three federal executions scheduled for this week, citing safety concerns due to COVID-19. The letter, released alongside the American Civil Liberties Union, says executions at the federal prison in Terre Haute have led to a spike in coronavirus cases among prisoners and staff. Two men scheduled for execution Thursday and Friday, Dustin Higgs and Corey Johnson, recently contracted COVID-19. A joint appeal now pending argues it would be cruel and unusual punishment to execute them while they're still recovering. This comes as a federal judge in Indiana issued a stay of tonight's scheduled execution of Lisa Montgomery, the only woman on federal death row. The government's already appealed the ruling. In a separate ruling, the U.S. Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit has also issued a stay. The government has not yet appealed that ruling at the time of our broadcast. The Trump administration revived the federal death penalty last year. Before then, there had not been a single federal execution since 2003, in almost 20 years. Since July, the federal government has executed 10 people, more than in any presidency since 1896, in more than 120 years. Government lawyers argue they cannot wait to conduct the executions because of the inconvenience of rescheduling the private contractors that carry it out would, quote, irreparably harm the government more than the prisoners would be irreparably harmed by dying. If tonight's execution proceeds, Lisa Montgomery would become the first woman put to death by the federal government in almost 70 years. She was sentenced to death in 2008 for the murder of a pregnant woman named Bobbi Jo Stinnett. Her lawyers argue that sexual abuse during her childhood led to mental illness. In November, attorney and advocate Sandra Babcock described the horrific childhood Montgomery suffered, a warning her answer is disturbing and graphic.
And she was a victim of incest, of gang rape, of child sex trafficking, of unimaginable violence for her entire life before she committed the crime for which she was sentenced to death. She is profoundly mentally ill. She began to dissociate when she was a teenager, when her father, her stepfather, built her a special room off the side of their trailer so he and his buddies could go in and rape her. Her mother sold her to the plumber and to the electrician, told her that she had to earn her keep. And so she obtained services after these men raped Lisa. And Lisa was left from these experiences as somebody who has the most fragile grip on reality because she had to escape from her reality in order to survive.
Ahead of Lisa Montgomery's execution, her sister Diane Mattingly begged for mercy. She, too, is a survivor of sexual abuse herself and described how the trauma they endured as children impacted them in their adult lives.
People have to understand that children that go through childhood abuse, it changes who they are. I went through that, and it took me years and years to overcome it. But I also had a good foundation that helped me overcome it. Lisa did not have that foundation, and she was broken. So please understand that. Now, because of COVID-19, I had a visit scheduled for last week. I couldn't go. I have another visit scheduled this week. I probably won't be able to go. I won't be able to see my sister, someone that I've loved since she was just a little itty bitty baby that I love today. But I won't be able to see her.
So there are now two court orders blocking tonight's execution of Lisa Montgomery. But as our next guest has reported, the Supreme Court's conservative majority cleared the way to proceed in the middle of the night for other executions by the Trump administration. We go to D.C., where we're joined by Isaac Arensdorf, reporter at ProPublica, whose investigative report is headlined Inside Trump and Barr's Last-Minute Killing Spree. Also with us from New Orleans is the well-known anti-death penalty activist sister Helen Prejean. Isaac, we're going to begin with you. What is the latest in Lisa Montgomery's case? Is she expected to be executed tonight, or will these stays hold? If she isn't, it could well be she won't die because Joe Biden is against the federal death penalty.
That's right. Time is running out for the Trump administration to go through with these three executions, and they know that, which is why they're very insistent that they happen this week and not after January 20th. And all indications are that they are going to do everything they can to do them this week. I can't predict what the Supreme Court will do. All I can tell you is that the situation that we're in today is very similar to a number of the previous executions, where on the day of the execution, there were court orders in place blocking them. And on appeal to the Supreme Court in the middle of the night after 2 a.m., the Supreme Court lifted those stays, and within a few hours, the prisoners were dead.
I'd like to bring in Sister Helen Prejean and ask you, there were five federal executions scheduled this lame duck period, breaking precedent from the past 130 years. Could you contextualize for us what's happening, why the Trump administration is doing this?
The root reason why Trump is doing this is simply because he has the power to do it. Executions, whether at the state level or the federal level, do not happen unless the prosecutor deliberately seeks death and seeks it all the way to the end. Trump has had the power all along. For some reason, he decides, starting in July, to start killing people. And for him, it's just like knocking cans off a fence. Let's choose this one, and this one. It just goes to show why we cannot, why the death penalty needs to be abolished completely, and you have to take the power out of individuals' hands to kill each other or not. It is the position now arrived at after a lot of dialogue in the Catholic Church that under no circumstances can governments be entrusted with this power over life and death.
Well, you wrote in a recent article in the Washington Post, an op-ed piece, that back 80% of Americans approved the death penalty back in 1993, but just 36% favored a life sentence without parole instead of the death penalty by 2019. What's contributed to this change in public views on the death penalty?
Education, persuasion. Giving people facts, telling them, bringing them as witnesses like myself, who's witnessed six executions, bringing them inside the killing chambers and telling them stories. Like, look at the Lisa Montgomery story. Unspeakable crime. Killing a pregnant woman and stealing and cutting the baby out. What could be worse than that? But then telling the whole story of the person. So when I wrote Dead Man Walking and it came out in 93, I think fully 90% in the southern state, Louisiana, supported the death penalty. So what do? You get out on the road, you go into churches, you go into civic groups, you go into schools, and you start talking to people. You just say, let me take you close to this. You know, I have been really heartened by the response of people, both to my book and to my lectures. And most of them say, I didn't know it was like this. They were made to be afraid. In the 80s, when we had the killing spree, we killed 8 people in 8.5 weeks in Louisiana. They were the people. When the people are made to be afraid, then the people tend to go for violence, for force to end a social problem. And they were told, these people are the worst of the worst. These people are evil. These people can't change. We can't put them in prison for even for a life sentence because they'll kill other inmates. It's their nature, their character. and they were made to be afraid. When people then can be educated, and especially now seeing that 172 wrongfully convicted people have come off a death row, that we're making mistakes right and left, mainly because 99% of the people chosen for the death penalty are poor and can't get a really crackerjack of defense. So truth doesn't come out at trial. You make mistakes. 172. This is astounding. For every 9 executions we've had in the United States, of the 1,500 plus execution by gassing people, shooting them, lethally injecting them, for every 9 executions, we've had to free one person. 1 in 9. That's how big the mistake rate is. Who would book an airline where they're going to tell you when you buy your ticket, okay, you got a 1 in 9 chance of reaching your destination? And that's impacted people. The American people are good people. When they're made to be afraid and they can't witness directly what's going on, there have been 2 court cases trying to make executions public, and they've both been defeated. It's a secret ritual. See, we all could witness the violence of what happened inside the Congress when the insurrection happened. We saw what happened with the guards being brought down to the floor and beat and stabbed and pummeled with the American flag and other. We saw, when you see the violence, you can be aghast at it. You could go, no. But when you don't see it, see, when Lisa's killed, if she's killed tonight, nobody is going to witness that. It's going to be inside, behind prison walls. There's saying, and I'll just finish right on this, in Latin America, what the eye does not see, the heart cannot feel. My job is to bring people inside the execution chambers and to give them facts about the death penalty. Education is what changes minds and hearts.
I wanted to put this question to Isaac Arnsdorf. When federal authorities used pentobarbital to execute Alfred Bourgeois last month on December 11th, he appeared to gasp for breath for nearly 28 minutes. Public radio reporter George Hale witnessed the execution and said it, quote, didn't go well and took almost twice as long as it took to kill Brandon Bernard one day earlier. Hale shared his notes from that night about watching Bourgeois' torso. They read, quote, not natural movement, stomach rising, stomach heaving, stomach popping up, heaving inside, sucking inside middle, still heaving. Hale tweeted, quote, if Alfred Bourgeois was suffering that night, he suffered for a long time. Can you talk about the significance of this and the battle of the Trump administration to get any drug possible and to expand the realm of killings to firing squad and poison gas if they can't get the drug?
Well, the reason that it took the Trump administration until the fourth year of the administration to restart these executions was because it needed to find a new drug that it could use in the lethal injections. And the previous drug became unavailable because of public pressure on the manufacturer to stop making it. So the administration is very jealously guarding the identity of its vendor. It's actually using what's called a compounding pharmacy, which kind of remixes a custom version of the drug. And that raises some concerns because actually the first batch of the drug failed a quality test from an independent lab. And so what the government did was took it to a different lab. But what you described at the Bourgeois killing, according to the Bourgeois execution, according to his lawyers and the lawyers for several of the other prisoners, the experience of lethal injection with this drug, which is a very powerful sedative, they have medical experts to testify that it is comparable to death by drowning, so a very painful and terrifying death. Now, the government has argued in response with its own medical experts testifying that they think that the prisoners would be unconscious during this process so that they would not feel the pain. And this is in particular an issue for the execution scheduled on Thursday and Friday for 2 prisoners who, according to their lawyers, have lung damage from COVID-19.
Isaac Arnsdorf, we're going to link to your remarkable pieces at ProPublica. And Sister Helen Prejean, thank you so much, world-renowned anti-death penalty activists. That does it for our show. Remember, wearing a mask is an act of love. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez.